Tonight, a northern suburbs pursuit comes to a crashing end as two suspects flee on foot. A cyclist airlifted to hospital after a Rottnest Island crash. The Perth Animal Shelter forced to turn away pets as the cost of living continues to bite. AFL skipper Jai Simkin flattened by an ugly bump, reigniting the concussion debate. Plus, the PM's pledge to struggling Aussies as he claims a birthday by-election victory. And how your smart device could save your life through a little-known feature.
This is Nine News Perth with Tracy Ver.
Good evening. A police pursuit in our northern suburbs has come to a crashing end with two suspects fleeing on foot. Live to Connor McGovern in Kundoola tonight. Connor, it happened right in front of a local soccer match.
Tracy, it was actually one of the cars belonging to one of the players in that soccer match that stopped the runaway vehicle. The two drivers were evading police through the streets of Kundoola when they tried to flee by driving through the back of these sporting change rooms, instead hitting a bollard and coming to a crashing halt when they struck the luxury vehicle just after 3 o'clock. The two offenders were then seen fleeing on foot, including one that tried to jump over a neighbouring fence. Police and their dogs in pursuit. Detectives now spending the afternoon bagging evidence, including more or around half a dozen mobile phones. This all happened, Tracy, in front of 50 people who were either playing in or watching that soccer match on the neighbouring field. Those witnesses were stunned by the scenes.
I saw the guy on the car just speeding off. I was trying to cut through down there and come through here. I went around and all I saw is cops going everywhere, and then I saw this happen.
All of a sudden, the car came through and hit one of my friend's car here. I had a big bang, but I didn't know, you know. One of the guy jumped out of the window and he ran across to the other road. Then he jumped the fence. The girl ran that way and then the guy ran that way.
Tracy, the last we heard, the offenders are still on the run. The tow truck has just taken away the smashed vehicle for forensics to swab it as they continue their investigations.
Quite the ordeal in Kundoola. Connor, thank you. A man is in hospital tonight after crashing his bicycle on Rottnest Island. Sarah Smith is at Royal Perth Hospital. Sarah, he was airlifted off the island.
Tracy, the 31-year-old was flown here by the Royal Flying Doctor Service after sustaining a head injury when he crashed his bike on Parker Point Road at about 11:30 this morning. He was assessed by staff on the island before being loaded into an RFDS helicopter and flown here to Perth. He's since undergone scans to assess the extent of his injury. His condition tonight listed as stable. Tracy, it's unclear whether the man was wearing a helmet.
All right, Sarah, thanks for the update. There's a plea tonight for further protections for our teachers in light of a confronting letter claiming aggressive students are driving staff shortages. The situation's so bad, one educator worries it'll take a death in the classroom for action to be taken.
A schoolyard turned into a ring. As students fight. And just this week, a teenager jailed for opening fire in Two Rocks last May. Australia's first school shooting.
There's a classroom at the end.
Violence in our schools. Tonight, teachers are calling for better protection.
All of the violence and all of the verbal assaults, all of the online behaviour, it's all contributing to teachers feeling unsafe.
The State School Teachers Union of WA responding to a letter penned by an anonymous educator, which claimed only a teacher being killed would prompt more protections. Reading, "I am faced with bad language and aggressive behaviour and have had objects thrown, threats made, and a desk tipped towards me."
We don't want to be too alarmist about it, but at the end of the day, our teachers, particularly at the coalface, are being confronted by some very intimidating situations.
Situations the teacher and union say is exacerbating an alleged exodus of teachers. The government has previously launched an action plan which arms schools with the resources needed to protect teachers, staff and students. The union did support its release, but now says it's not enough.
Violence is a community problem, but saying that isn't enough to fix it.
Connor McGovern, Nine News.
After months of international attention, thousands of sheep and cattle are finally leaving our shores. The MV Bahija departing Fremantle Port late this afternoon, attempting to make the journey to the Middle East again. The livestock has spent at least 5 weeks in limbo because of tensions in the Red Sea. A grandmother and toddler involved in a horrific driveway emergency in Edgewater are tonight still in hospital undergoing major surgery. The 67-year-old woman requiring an operation on her rib cage, shoulder blades and her arm after suffering multiple broken bones when a vehicle rolled down her steep driveway, running over the pair on Friday afternoon. She's still in a critical but stable condition, while the toddler is also stable at Perth Children's Hospital. Police across New South Wales could have their every move monitored amid calls for GPS trackers to be installed in their guns. The push follows the alleged murders of Luke Davies and Jesse Baird, who were remembered at last night's Mardi Gras, Luke's mother joining her son's friends in the parade.
There was no hiding it. Behind the glitter, at times it felt like the Mardi Gras was an all-dancing, all-singing wake to honour Luke Davies and Jesse Baird. At the start, just for a minute, the big bikes fell silent. Luke Davies' friends said Mardi Gras was his favourite night of the year. His Qantas colleagues held him in such esteem, they named their float after him. And marching behind, unknown to most, Luke's mum, Sandy.
We're walking with us tonight, and that is just a special moment to share with her. That embracer is our love.
All week there was plenty of talk about police not being welcome, with one of their own charged with Luke and Jesse's murders.
It's been a really challenging week for everyone. The loss of those two beautiful young men has been quite heartbreaking for so many in our community.
However, a small group of officers, not in uniform, were embraced as part of the LGBT family.
It's great. We've had a tough week and it's been great.
Actor and activist Hugh Sheridan was a friend of Luke's.
I hope that tonight brings a lot of healing for everyone, because I certainly know Luke was just the sweetest person.
When Bolamar Condon allegedly shot and killed Jesse and Luke here in Paddington, no one in the force seemed to be aware he was in possession of a police-issued Glock pistol. Now there are calls within the force for GPS locators to be installed on weapons so armed officers can be tracked within the community. In Paddington, Mark Burrows, Nine News.
The Prime Minister is celebrating what was a tough by-election win for the Victorian seat of Dunkley, despite the swing going to the Liberal Party. Votes are still being counted and it's clear the number one issue in the community is still cost of living.
Sipping on success. The Prime Minister and Jody Bellier after a bruising by-election win.
The hard work starts now and the hard work of our government will continue.
Last night...
I'm a mum from Frankston with two dogs and a mortgage, and I'm going to be your member for Dunkley.
Jody Bellier winning the seat with 52.7% of the two-party vote, a 3.6% swing against the government with votes still being counted. If replicated nationally, 11 seats would be lost.
That puts Anthony Albanese in the Labor government into minority government, or possibly could put us back in power.
Nathan Conroy defeated, but about to be a dad again.
Just before I came up on the stage, my wife whispered in my ear that we are having our second child.
Liberal sources say he's already being sounded out for another run.
6.3% is not a marginal seat. But by hell, it's a marginal seat now. So congratulations.
I think Peter Dutton can take a lot out of this. This is game on. This is really game on.
As counting continued, some of the bigger swings in booths where voters were doing it tough.
The message is, if you get it wrong on cost of living, it could cost your government. With job now done here in Dunkley, attention will move to the federal budget.
I've already foreshadowed that we'll have more measures in the budget. We work each and every day to do more.
Well, it'll be a big part of the budget. You know, that is the biggest issue in the country at the moment. It's what all Australians are focused on, and it's what we're focused on as well.
We go to bed every night and we'll do so from here on in, thinking about how we can improve Australians' lives, how we can make the family budget better.
Charles Croucher, Nine News.
The feeling tonight in the Labor camp is relief. Beyond the usual expectation management, there was a genuine concern among Labor that the Liberal Party may have won that seat last night. Now, with wages rising faster than inflation, with a tax cut on the way, a budget in May and potential interest rate cuts likely, there is a feeling among the government that things will get easier for Australian households, and that will mean elections get easier for the government. As for Peter Dutton, Winston Churchill used to say you should deserve victory. Well, if a leader doesn't show on polling day to change some votes or at least to motivate and thank his volunteers, then that leader doesn't deserve victory.
The United States has airdropped food into Gaza for the first time as the humanitarian crisis there worsens. The move is tonight being seen as a last resort by increasingly frustrated US officials, with time running out for a ceasefire deal to be struck.
On board a US military aircraft, pallets of humanitarian aid are packed, placed onto tracks and pushed into place. The carefully orchestrated mission begins. Three C-130 Hercules take off, bound for Gaza. Once high above the enclave, the pallets are released. 66 all up, carrying 38,000 ready-to-eat meals. Parachutes helping guide them towards the coastline. It's the first round of humanitarian airdrops by the US Air Force. On the ground, screams as they pass overhead. More drops will follow. It's welcomed, but it doesn't come close to what's needed. The UN says a quarter of Gaza's 2.3 million people are starving. At least 115 now confirmed dead when crowds swarmed trucks on Thursday. Israeli forces have been accused of opening fire.
These events cannot be allowed to go on. We need to have safe, secure passage throughout Gaza.
Despite the airdrops, air strikes continue. Many killed and dozens injured in Rafah, according to Gaza's health ministry. The area surrounding the Emirati hospital was targeted, this man says. Pressure for a ceasefire agreement ahead of Ramadan, beginning on March 10th, grows by the day. It's understood the framework for a six-week ceasefire has been accepted, but sticking points remain.
We're still working real hard at it, not there yet.
What is the biggest holdup right now?
I'm not going to tell you that because I would get involved in the negotiations.
Israeli War Cabinet Minister Benny Gantz heading to the US and then the UK for high-level meetings as the situation becomes more desperate. Some Israeli media reporting Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu didn't know beforehand. In London, Edward Godfrey, Nine News.
A Perth dog shelter says it's in crisis, with desperate WA families surrendering their animals at a rapid rate. The refuge receives more than 100 calls a week. The situation's so dire, it's now turning pets away.
It's meant to be a temporary stay, but some of these dogs have been here for years, desperate to find their forever home.
They're just also deserving of a home, and it's sad that they can't reach their full potential.
The Dogs Refuge home in Shenton Park seeing a record number of surrenders, the worst it's been in 90 years. They get around 15 calls a day from people unable to look after their pets.
Nobody can find rentals, or the rentals are threatening to kick them out if they don't get rid of their dog. People just can't afford their dogs anymore as well. They're choosing to fuel up their car or get groceries.
The refuge usually has around 60 dogs. Right now they've got double that, with a further 55 in foster care. The situation so dire, the shelter has been forced to turn some animals away. Volunteers working around the clock, giving up their weekends to care for the pups.
These dogs should not be here. They're here through no fault of their own.
Staff urging owners to sterilise their dogs to avoid unwanted litters. If you're not in a position to adopt a dog, fostering is a good option. The refuge always in need of more volunteers to help take care of dogs like Daphne.
And we won't stop regardless of how many dogs are coming. We will just keep coming in.
Sarah Smith, Nine News.
Sydney's Oxford Street has sparkled with every colour of the rainbow, with more than 130,000 people celebrating the annual Mardi Gras parade. History was made across the night, but that was quickly hijacked by protesters.
It started on the tray of a ute in 1978, a movement not just surviving but thriving through the decades. The original movers and shakers, pride of place.
We've come a long way and I'm really pleased about that.
Hand in hand with the next generation. A collective sense of pride shining brighter than any float, dress or tiara. Rainbow sparks lighting up the sky over Oxford Street. Confetti showers eclipsed by a sprinkle, but there was no chance the weather could rain on this parade. Rock royalty Queen frontman Adam Lambert bringing the party.
The energy is amazing. I'm really thrilled to be here. I dropped a new song for tonight just for Sydney.
In step with the crowd, Chris Minns making history as the first premier to march in Mardi Gras. A milestone moment not missed by pro-Palestinian protesters. Some confronting politicians with banners and flares. An interruption that only lasted seconds. Uniformed officers quick to take down the masked activists, dragging them off the strip. 9 arrested, 8 charged with using violence to cause fear. Too close for comfort for the Premier, slipping out straight after the incident, surrounded by security. Today, playing it down.
It didn't really affect me too much. In fact, with the coloured flares and the banner, I thought it was part of Mardi Gras.
And the show went on for the other 135,000 celebrating well into the morning. Sophie Upcroft, 9 News.
The AFL has been rocked by an ugly on-field incident that flattened North Melbourne captain Jai Simkin. Paddy Sweeney, it's reignited calls for a send-off rule.
Yeah, it has, Tracy. The brutal bump was laid by St Kilda's Jimmy Webster, and with the concussion debate ongoing, it now threatens to overshadow the season opener.
It's sickening, it's crude, and it's about to reshape the concussion debate yet again.
Nice and late from Jimmy, just too high, leaves the ground.
In the immediate aftermath, a fight breaks out. The culprit, St Kilda's Jimmy Webster, circled by North Melbourne players as Roos captain Jai Simkin lays motionless on the ground before grabbing at his neck.
He's not in a good way.
He doesn't look in a good way.
A closer look at the incident shows Webster's feet leaving the ground. It's exactly the type of incident the AFL is trying to stamp out of the game.
We don't want to see that. So he'll get dealt with quite harshly, you would think.
Players are repeatedly told not to leave the ground. So
it's just stupid, isn't it?
It's just stupid.
Yep.
Reaction to online from North Melbourne's own social media team. The incident reposted along with the comment, Simpkin hit high and late. Rival players also weighed in from Mason Cox. Makes me think there should be a sin bin or some kind of in-game ramification for these things. While Roos champion David King said, 10 weeks, simple as that. It's not as if players weren't on notice. Just a few days ago, Sam Powell-Pepper was rubbed out for 4 matches for this ugly hit. Now it's back to the tribunal for a case and a potential penalty that could dwarf that of the Power Star.
This here is worse. He's left the ground, he's chosen to bump. He's chosen to bump him in the head.
We either get rid of incidents like this, and 5 or 6 is probably the right for the bill.
As for Simpkin, he has an unfortunate history with concussion, missing 2 games after 2 separate incidents last season. He spent the remainder of this match on the bench, and with 13 days until the club's season opener, he's almost certain to miss a round one clash with the Giants.
I just saw him really briefly then, and yeah, he seemed fine. He'll obviously enter concussion protocols from here, and we'll let our doctors and our medical team, take care of him from here.
In recent weeks, the debate has been heightened, first by a concussion class action led by Max Rook, and then by the early retirement of Melbourne Premiership star Angus Brayshaw.
It's a really fast game, faster than ever. These things happen really quickly, so yeah, we can only take Jimmy for the person that he is, and he's been a great character and a great servant for our club.
Clint Stanaway, 9 News.
And Tracy, it's the very action the AFL is currently trying to stamp out of the game, and there will be no doubt some major ramifications.
And no doubt more discussion and debate about it too.
Absolutely.
All right, Paddy, we'll see you soon. Thanks very much. A cyclist is crediting his smartwatch with saving his life. Still to come tonight, how a little-known tech feature detected his fall, called 000, and even sent a text message to his wife. From falls to heart failure, how the technology can work for you, coming up a little later in the bulletin. Thunderstorms lit up parts of Perth overnight. Natalia Cooper, did we get much rain?
Good evening to you, Tracy. Unfortunately, the storms didn't leave much in the gauges, but they were impressive. Check out this incredible photo that Lauren took at the Pink concert at Optus Stadium. This shot of a lightning bolt was snapped by Isaac in Maylands, while Esme Wood in Baldivis took this stunning picture. Let's take a look at the radar overnight. And Bickley received 3 millimetres, while 2.4 millimetres landed in Rolleystone's gauge. Gooseberry Hill recorded a 96 kilometre per hour wind gust at midnight. Now, storms dumped heavier falls on some regional centres in the 24 hours to 9 this morning. Hyden received 48 millimetres of rain. Corrigan had 20, with more falling today. And a severe storm warning is currently in place for parts of the southeast coast, Great Southern, Central Wheatbelt and Goldfields. It was a warm night here in Perth. 25.9 was as cool as it got, and today was very muggy and a warm 34.6 degrees. There's a chance of a shower or two tomorrow. I'll be back with the full forecast a little later, Tracy.
We'll see you soon, Natalia. Thank you. A lucky escape for a southern suburbs family as their home goes up in flames. Next, find out what sparked this Baldivis blaze. Shoppers mowed down as an out-of-control car ploughs into a Walmart store. Inside WA's film and TV production boom, what it means for local jobs. And Kylie Minogue's twist on tradition as she takes out a global award. That's later. A homeowner is lucky to be alive after his southern suburbs home was destroyed by fire. Emergency crews called to the house in Baldivis just after 10 this morning, with the blaze causing the roof to collapse. The home completely gutted by flames.
It was quite a large response because of the full involvement and the temperature of today. It's quite a hot day, so it's quite hard work for the crews. So we brought in additional crews to manage fatigue.
It's believed the fire started in the air conditioning unit. The cost of living crisis has left some struggling to keep their homes cool and themselves healthy. Tonight, calls for the federal government to help retrofit homes and introduce minimum building standards before it's too late.
Usually a shelter, but not in summer heat. Julie's one-bedroom rental doesn't have air conditioning or inbuilt fans.
I just have to suffer through the heat. I have icy drinks, flannel and lie down, and that's about all I can do.
She's one of many Australians in poorly insulated homes and unable to afford upgrades, or not allowed to, because she doesn't own it. According to an Australian Council of Social Services report, 80% of people in financial stress say their homes get too hot and are suffering ill health as a result.
If you're on a low income, particularly if you're in a rental property, you are absolutely stuck in these hot boxes.
Prolonged heat events can have a profound effect. It can destabilise the cardiovascular system. It can lead to collapse. It can lead to kidney or liver failure. If it's not treated, it can be very, very severe.
We need now a major investment in the retrofitting of low-income housing across the country. Access to solar panels, the best of insulation, overhead fans.
The government says they're doing just that.
In the last budget, we had a $1.7 billion program. Of course, there's an enormous task ahead of us. That's a very big investment, and the states have made very big investments in these things as well.
However, advocacy groups say this only covers a small percentage of the upgrades required. They say they want more money in the upcoming federal budget as Australian summers get more extreme. While the start of autumn may bring some relief, Julie worries our homes aren't prepared for a future that's only getting hotter.
In another 20 years, the temperatures might be 45 regularly, and if there's no air conditioning, people won't get through it.
Amanda Kopp, Nine News.
An apartment block in the Russian city of St. Petersburg has been damaged and 6 people injured by what local media say was a drone attack. Several people were killed in the Ukrainian city of Odessa when debris from a Russian drone struck a building. Former US President Donald Trump has won the Missouri and Idaho primaries for the 2024 Republican presidential nomination. It comes ahead of Super Tuesday, which will see 16 states vote in the primaries race. Trump is unbeaten so far. This Walmart in the US will need more than just a clean-up in aisle 6 after a car ploughed 14 metres into the store. 5 people, including the driver, were taken to hospital with non-life-threatening injuries. Our queen of pop, Kylie Minogue, has taken an Aussie tradition to the UK, performing a shoey from a stiletto at the Brit Awards. The superstar was honoured as a global icon at this year's ceremony before singing a medley of her greatest hits to a packed arena. WA is in the midst of a film and TV production boom, and the Perth Hills is centre stage. A new black comedy, Birthright, is being filmed, providing jobs and new opportunities for the region.
Nestled in the Perth Hills, it's lights, camera, action for Birthright.
We're on set in Darlington, on the set of a first-time filmmaker's feature film, Birthright.
The dark comedy, written and directed by Zoe Pepper, follows a couple in their 30s who are pregnant but forced to move back in with their retired parents.
It's really about kind of intergenerational inequality and then very much looking at sort of the housing crisis that's very front and centre at the moment. Watching my own friends and my sisters moving back in with parents and seeing those kind of power dynamics.
Shot over 5 weeks in Darlington, it continues a record period of screen production in WA.
Oh, it's incredible and amazing to see like so many talented crew working so hard to execute my vision.
We're probably in a record growth period at the moment in West Australia for the screen sector. Last year was massive and this year's going to be even bigger.
In the past 2 years, production has begun on 41 films and TV projects, including The Surfer and Yelling Up, starring Nicolas Cage.
Quite a significant piece of talent that was down in that region and causing a lot of buzz.
Screen West creating more than 3,500 jobs and injecting $41 million into the WA economy.
The creative industries is a really important part of our economy, and being able to provide ongoing work on film production is just going to make this a better place for creatives to live.
With diverse landscapes and buildings from here in the hills to our golden beaches, the vast array of potential filming locations are drawing crews from across the country and the world.
West Australia can be exotic to many people, whether it's international talent or national talent.
Rachel Clifford, Nine News.
Still to come this Sunday, Ocean Spectacular. What's behind this incredible light show off an Australian beach? Renovators delight inside the restoration of TV and radio personality Andy Lee's 150-year-old mansion. We meet the Aussie boxer making Olympic history before she's even thrown a punch. And keeping watch, the smart devices living up to their name and saving lives. That's later. A photographer on South Australia's Kangaroo Island has spent 2 nights capturing the bright lights of the ocean lit up in a rare natural display. Vivonne Bay turning into a bioluminescent wonderland as the rough sea stirred up a magical sight.
This spectacular scenery snapped overnight in one of South Australia's own paradises.
Incredible, like life-changing. It was just beautiful. Like, it was one of the best nights.
Even the Milky Way came out to have a look at the bioluminescent algae bloom occurring in Vivonne Bay on Kangaroo Island late last night and the night before. Friends of Linda Irwin alerted her to the rare event, and the amateur photographer didn't hesitate, jumping straight out of bed.
I had my zebra print pyjamas on and went down there, and it was fun.
Similar events have stirred up excitement in areas like Port Lincoln in the past. Experts from UniSA say the natural phenomenon is a mixture of the recent warm weather and nutrients in the water. The stars aligning when movement in the waves caused the neon blue flare-up.
It's not very often that you see that at Vivonne, and to that strength as well. The activity was incredible.
It's not the first time Linda's managed to turn her lens towards rare events. This stunning aurora captured last November, also on KI, remains her favourite piece.
Kangaroo Island is really, really special, and it's a photographer's dream, honestly.
Will DeFulvio, Nine News.
Work will soon begin on restoring a crumbling 150-year-old Melbourne mansion owned by celebrity couple Beck Harding and Andy Lee. The man set to bring it back to life is award-winning designer David Flack, and he says he's never tackled a project this tough.
It's a renovator's dream home by the Yarra in leafy Hawthorne, complete with spiders, indoor vegetation, and its fair share of inbuilt quirks.
Look at that. It's a porthole. Apparently one of the past owners years and years and years ago was into shipping, so got this put in.
off an actual ship.
Rebecca Harding and Andy Lee have fallen in love with the weirdness of the 150-year-old mansion known as Ravens Hall. They bought the property 2 years ago for more than $8 million.
It was actually a Nine News story that my mum saw and texted me a video of watching it and said, I found your new house, as a joke. And then we actually walked through and went, oh my gosh, I think this could be it.
Since then, the couple's grappled with the question of how to bring the home into the 21st century. Enter designer David Flack, Vogue Living's Creative of the Year.
It's really just understanding our client and the architecture or the space.
I feel like he just designs houses that are so personal.
Flack won the prestigious title in part thanks to his body of work, including singer Troy Sivan's home in Carlton.
I'm just, like, obsessed with all this detailing and everything, and there's a massive skylight above my head as well, which is sick.
David blew us away. They managed to be able to honour this and let it sit on its own and be the hero, and cleverly have kind of built in a more modern living space which we wanted.
Really utilising that landscape and the fall on the land towards the Yarra.
The riverfront mansion will remain near the street but will be flipped.
It was built when they used to come in off the river, so the front door is actually on the back side of the property and
its arse faces the street. It's mooning everybody.
A new living space will also be built at the back of the block.
And they've got these clever designs kind of connected through tunnels, which kind of 12-year-old me is so excited because I just loved a tunnel when I was little.
It's kind of nice to have the play between the two houses and how they connect to one another.
As far as designs go, it doesn't get much harder than this. The home certainly has good bones, but that's about it. There's no kitchen, there's no bathroom, there's no power, and there's no plumbing.
We've never had a project like this, and I don't think there is a project like this that exists.
There'll be elements of the old Ravenswood that will live on.
That was one of my non-negotiables to the architects. I said, we've got to keep this.
Flack hopes to pay tribute to the mansion's past while giving it new life. Work on the mega project will begin in the next few months.
When's it all finished, Beck?
Andy will be about 90.
In reality, the big reveal could be close to 3 years away, but good things take time. Reid Butler, Nine News.
An Aussie boxer bound for Paris will make history even before she's thrown a punch. Tina Rahimi will become the first female Muslim to represent Australia in the ring at an Olympics.
Boxer Tina Rahimi has the community in her corner.
Congratulations, so awesome.
The green and gold outfit to go with her hijab. She's dressed and ready to make history.
I wish her all the best. Thank you. She's the best.
And who is to argue? The 27-year-old from Bankstown is set to become Australia's first female Muslim boxer to compete at an Olympics.
To be honest, like, it still hasn't hit me yet.
I love it when you say it hasn't hit me yet. Yeah. You've hit quite a few to get there.
Yeah, I have.
Tina booked her place at the Pacific Games in the Solomon Islands in December.
And there she is. Look, she knows.
Yeah.
She knows.
She's going to Paris.
Before jumping into the ring, she was at the beauty parlour. Tina was a makeup artist.
It was quite funny. A lot of my clients would come in and I'll do their makeup and they'll be like, oh, please don't punch me in the face.
Stumbling on a boxing class at a local gym 7 years ago kick-started Tina's journey to Paris and hopefully Olympic glory. Along the way, she's knocked out competitors and knocked down barriers.
I just hope that I can show these women that you can do these things and still be true to yourself and to your beliefs and your faith without being uncomfortable.
Tina and her Australian Olympic teammate, Tiana Echegaray, train twice a day, 6 days a week. An Olympic gold medal is the prize, but she knows she's already won a major title.
To know that I'll be an Olympian for the rest of my life, it's like I can just tell that to everyone. Like, it's a name, it's something that you'd be proud of. Like, not everyone can call themselves an Olympian.
Damien Ryan, Nine News.
The wrist device is saving lives when no one else is around to help. After sport, meet the everyday Aussies lucky to be alive thanks to smart technology. And country clean-up, why hundreds of thousands of volunteers across the country spent the day collecting rubbish. But Paddy Sweeney is back with sport now. Paddy, pre-season has ended in controversy.
That it has, Tracy. Days out from the season opener, the concussion debate is back in the headlines. Saint turns sinner as a defender's big hit lands him in hot water. Perfect 10 as Lion leaves the Black Caps in a spin. And twice as nice, Diminor doubles up in Mexico. St Kilda will start the season minus two key defenders, with Jimmy Webster staring down a lengthy suspension and Dougal Howard hurting his hamstring. The double blow taking some gloss off the Saints' 19-point victory over North Melbourne.
The decision to bump will prove costly for Jimmy Webster.
Nice and late from Jimmy, just too high, leaves the ground. It's just stupid.
Yep. The defender to be suspended for his hit on North captain Jai Simkin. The question now, for how long?
Obviously, the incident for the AFL to look at, and we'll just see what unfolds from there and take it from there.
Webster with the target on his back for the rest of the day.
So he knows he's in for a rough afternoon.
Dougal Howard's also set to miss the start of the season after hurting his hamstring.
He's one that has a really good pre-season, hasn't missed a bit, so, you know, if it is a few weeks, hopefully he can get back quite quickly.
Former Docker Liam Henry impressing in the 19-point win.
Oh. And then throws in the party trick and says, I'm now a Saner.
There were also positives for North, fans with their first glimpse of Zane Dersma and liking what they saw.
Chance to press his case for a spot in round one, and if he keeps kicking him like that, he'll be playing, he's got his second.
The Carlton Army out in force at Fan Day, sending their heroes off for some Brisbane revenge.
Obviously returning to scene of the crime in a way, and yeah, it'll be exciting to get back up there.
Sam Walsh set to miss Friday's match. The injured star ran this morning, but his back troubles kept him indoors. Dual Brownlow medalist Lachie Neal confident he'll be right following off-season groin surgery.
I might manage my minutes a little bit, but it won't change. It won't change too much. I feel fit. I've got a lot of kilometres in the last few months, so ready to go.
Australia have taken out the first test against New Zealand with a stunning performance from Nathan Lyon on day four. The off-spinner taking four wickets on the final day, finishing with 10 wickets for the match, but was unable to topple WA's Cameron Green for Player of the Match honours.
It was always going to be an uphill battle for the hosts heading into day four, especially with Nathan Lyon on fire.
Catch it!
Out. Yeah! Out. He didn't have to wait long until his second wicket of the day.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Or his third.
Head on the pads and gone.
It was a two-horse race for player of the match, Cameron Green building his case with a wicket of his own.
Oh, that's bounced and is going to be out.
Lyon taking his sixth of the innings not long after.
Zopp has another go one-handed. And that one will not go far enough.
And while Green won the honours, thanks to his 174 not out in the first innings, kudos was also due to Nathan Lyon, a 10-wicket haul.
I thought he was brilliant over the last couple of days, bouncing through a few different plans, but just always felt like he was in control.
It was the 36-year-old's fifth 10-wicket match of his career, and he's not showing any signs of slowing down soon.
I would absolutely love if he was playing until 2027, and I don't think there's much that's going to get in his way, so I already told him the day he retires, I'm definitely giving up the captaincy because it makes my life a hell of a lot easier.
The Aussies retaining the Trans-Tasman trophy, and they'll face New Zealand again on Friday in Christchurch. Trent Neese, Nine News.
Josh Inglis has starred as WA require 9 wickets for victory in their Sheffield Shield clash with Queensland. WA declaring at 7 for 307, setting the Bulls 447. Inglis marking his first four-day match of the season in style, smashing an unbeaten 136.
A century for Josh Inglis, in innings of high quality.
And Will Pekowski's future is again in doubt after being struck in the head.
Oh, here we go. This is not good.
The 26-year-old was able to walk from the ground unassisted, but there's now growing concerns Cricket Australia will allow him to play again, given his extensive concussion history. Well, it was touted as the most spectacular season opener in more than 100 years of rugby league, and the NRL certainly delivered, kicking its season off Las Vegas style. The Sydney Roosters taking down the Brisbane Broncos in the Battle of the States, with the Sydney side starting their 2024 campaign with a bang.
Now Ezra Mann throws an intercept. Manu! Joey Manu with a gift wrap try.
A little earlier, Americans learned pretty quickly just how tough rugby league is. South Sydney and Manly facing off, the Sea Eagles winning 36-24. Alex Dimonor has won back-to-back titles for the first time in his career. The Australian was at his blistering best, defending his Mexican Open crown with a straight sets win over Casper Ruud.
No! Oh, no way! How has he won that point?
It's about as incredible a point that you'll see.
It's his eighth singles title, keeping him inside the world's top 10. And as you can see, he also scores a lovely souvenir. English Premier League leaders Liverpool have snatched a dramatic winner. Meanwhile, Tottenham continuing their strong form, scoring three goals in a comeback win against Crystal Palace. Despite the result, though, they still remain outside the top four. And high drama has surrounded West Australian F1 driver Daniel Ricciardo after he was ordered to overtake teammate Yuki Tsunoda late into the Bahrain GP.
Yuki, driver swap. Driver swap.
Are you kidding me now?
Tsunoda didn't take the team orders nicely, launching past the Aussie in their cool-off lap post-race. Ricciardo not mincing his words after the incident.
It's a f***ing helmet.
Ricciardo finishing 13th behind fellow Aussie Oscar Piastri in 8th. Max Verstappen taking out the season opener comfortably, aiming for four world titles in a row. Tracy, high drama there to finish in Bahrain. Fair to say that Max is going to be very hard to chase down yet again.
And might be a tough relationship between Ricciardo
and
for that team with Ricciardo indeed. All right, Paddy, thanks very much. Next, from calls to 000 to life-saving text messages, the unknown smartwatch features helping save lives, plus thousands pull on their gloves to clean up Australia. And Natalia Cooper, a shower or two to kick off the week.
Yes, Tracy, we may get a millimetre tomorrow morning, but the rest of the week is looking fine and warm. Your full forecast is coming up.
A cyclist who was knocked out by a kangaroo has credited his smartwatch for saving his life. His Apple Watch detected his fall, sent a text message to his wife and dialed 000.
When Apple, Samsung, Google and others talk up fall detection, most people, like Bruce Mildenhall, think they'll never need it. Until a kangaroo crashes into their bike at speed in the Macedon Ranges.
I woke up with a giant neck brace on and I thought, oh God, what have I done here? Then there was this bang, bang, bang on the side of the ambulance and it was my wife saying, have you got Bruce Mildenhall in there? Is he alive?
Bruce's wife got a text from his Apple Watch, which detected his fall and called 000 with his location.
I had all the help I needed for what could have been a pretty tragic accident, but it was all through technology that the help got to me in the time that I really needed it.
That story will appear in Apple's new health and safety campaign, alongside Lexi Northcott. Lexi didn't know she was at extreme risk of heart failure until getting warning after warning on the watch she received for her 16th birthday.
We got sent straight to Melbourne, and that night we worked out that I had a complete heart block.
If Lexi didn't have these notifications, there's no way known we would have known there was anything wrong with it.
Not every smartwatch has these features, but the big brands, Apple, Samsung, Withings, all have these features that essentially are monitoring your heart rate constantly.
As useful as the readings were for Lexi, tech companies are quick to point out that their smartwatches are no substitute for real medical tests. And if you think something's wrong, you should definitely consult your clinician.
We're just going to try to continue to invest in those places where, hopefully users don't really have to think about using these features, but when they need them, they're there and they can make this really big impact on their lives.
I never take my watch off. I don't feel safe without it on.
I'd really think that if she didn't have that watch on today or then, she wouldn't be here.
You can compare some of the health and safety features of the most popular smartwatches on our website. Mark Santomartino, Nine News.
Hundreds of thousands of Aussies did the dirty work today, collecting rubbish from their local communities for Clean Up Australia Day. More than 750,000 volunteers picked up litter across 10,000 sites around the country, the majority of it soft plastics and cigarette butts. Stay with us. Natalia is back with your weather details right after this break.
Welcome back. Storms in parts of Perth overnight, and today was very muggy and warm. It was really warm at night as well. 26 degrees was the low before we climbed to a top of 35, and right now it's sitting on 29. To the charts, and a storm warning is current for parts of the central wheat belt, the southeast coast and goldfields. Perth could pick up a shower or two tomorrow morning in southerly winds as a weak cold front brushes past. Across the nation tomorrow, up to 20 millimetres of rain for Brisbane. A partly cloudy day for Sydney, 21 in Melbourne. Back in the north of our state, a storm is possible in Kununurra, Broome, Marble Bar and Newman. Further south, becoming windy in Geraldton, a shower or two for Albany and Esperance, and the chance of a storm and 38 in Kalgoorlie. A strong wind warning on the waters tomorrow. Southwesterly winds 10 to 15 knots, turning southerly in the late morning, and then winds will reach up to 30 knots later. Seas to 2 metres and swell below a metre. Around the suburbs tomorrow, a shower or two in Joondalup with a possible shower for Swanbourne, Fremantle and Mandra. So the official Perth forecast, a cloudy morning followed by a mostly sunny afternoon. There's also a 50% chance of a shower or two in the morning, 28 the top after a low of 20 overnight. Looking ahead, sunshine and 31 on Tuesday, warming up to 33 on Wednesday and a hot 35 degrees on Thursday. Friday will be mostly sunny and 32, dipping below 30 on Saturday before it climbs back up to 32 on Sunday. So the chance of a shower tomorrow, but we probably won't see too much in the gauges, Trace.
All right, Natalia, thanks so much. And that is Nine News this Sunday. Thanks for your company from the team. Enjoy your evening and good night.